podcast is brought to you by LMU Munich.
Thank you very much. As the rest of the speakers, let me, before starting, to thank the organizers for the invitation to this very interesting and important conference. I'm very happy to be here. The title of my talk is, as you can see from the transparency, Black Holes as a Quantum Phase Transition, or you want probably a better title will be Black Holes as the Critical Point of a Quantum Phase Transition. What I will try to do during the talk is to summarize the essential aspects of a program of work that I am developing for a couple of years together with Gia Valli, but I will concentrate today in this preprint that appears recently, last week, I believe. Of course, along these months, we have been collaborating with other people in several aspects of this program, and I would like to mention here Jan Judice, Alex Kehagias, and Dieter Lust. Then, to summarize a little bit what I will try to do in the talk, what essentially I will try is to provide some amount of evidence on two interconnected claims that at first sight can look a little bit too radical, but okay, let me just continue and we'll see what happened before at the end of the seminar. The two claims are, the first one is that the quantum theory of Einsteinian gravitons, by that what I mean is massless particle of spin 2 in Minkowski space-time, with interaction vertices, defining the Feynman diagrams of the corresponding quantum field theory, determined by the Einstein action. The claim is that, we would like to argue that this quantum theory of gravitons is ubiquicomplete. By that, what we mean is that the scattering amplitudes at ultra-Planckian energies can be unitarized without adding any extra fundamental degree of freedom. The key mechanism that I will try to describe in the next transparency of this sort of supporting this claim of ubiquicompletion is what we have Christianized as classicalization, and I will explain in a moment what it means. The second interconnected claim, of course, related, whenever you try to address the problem of quantum gravity, you need to address these two problems. One is the perturbative problem and another is the non-perturbative problem, is that black holes in asymptotically flat space can be interpreted or can be modeled as Bose-Einstein condensates, self-sustained in the sense that, as I will explain, the quantum pressure balances the gravitational interaction of weakly interacting soft gravitons. Moreover, and this is the origin of the title of the talk, who will claim that the black holes can be interpreted precisely as being at the critical point of a particular quantum phase transition taking place in this Bose-Einstein condensate of gravitons. Simplifying a lot, the two basic problems of quantum gravity on which we will focus this talk are the problem of unitarization of scattering amplitudes at ultra-Planckian energies. Of course, you simply compute using the perturbation rules. What you get is that this scattering amplitudes grow with the center of mass energy, and you need some mechanisms of unitarization. We know, of course, some mechanisms of unitarization, and this, for instance, string theory provides one beautiful approach to the scattering amplitudes, and we will make some contact with it in a moment. And the second problem is to account for the microscopic origin of the black hole entropy. This beautiful formula of Bekenstein and Hawking that tells us that the entropy of black holes is 1/4 of the area of the horizon in units of the Planck length. The typical Wilsonian recipe, and this is just speaking in very loose terms, the typical Wilsonian recipe to address this type of problems will be to integrate in some extra degrees of freedom, and at the same time to use them in order to solve both problems, to solve perturbative unitarity, just putting these extra degrees of freedom in this channel, and to account for the black hole entropy. In this talk, I will follow a slightly different path, but sharing some connection, as we will see, probably, with the Wilsonian recipe. And this the path is based on the notion of classicalization. This is the next transparency. I will try to sketch a little bit in a cartoon, probably, what classicalization means for us. What is classicalization? Everybody knows what is quantization. Quantization is a typical correspondence rule between C numbers that describe physics or physical quantities in the classical realm, when h bar is equal to zero, into operators, which are the typical representatives of physical observables when h bar is different from zero. In a certain sense, as a sort of a slogan, classicalization is just the inverse map to quantization, but, and this is important, keeping h bar different from zero. In other words, we want to see if we can change operators into C numbers, keeping h bar different from zero. Of course, everybody knows when this thing can be done in quantum mechanics, and this will happen whenever the occupation number of the typical problem we are dealing with, that we call m from now on, is much larger than one. In many body physics, this is known essentially, this is known as Bogoliubov approximation. In particular, you consider in many body physics a quantum state of large occupation number n, and you define your creation annihilation operators by the standard rules. For n much larger than one, in principle, you can safely transform these operators into C numbers. But you keep at the same time h bar equals zero, different from zero. In other words, classicalization for us is large n physics, where this n refers to occupation number, but quantum physics. Then the next natural question after this introduction is under what condition we can use this classicalization in order, if any, to solve the problem of UV completion. Of course, the natural answer is that we can use this classicalization in order to solve or to address the problem of UV completion if and only if we are dealing with theories where increasing the energy unavoidably leads to increase the occupation number n. We claim, and we will claim, and now we will try to provide some evidence that this is the typical case of gravity, and we will try to see a little bit this thing from the point of view of the renormalization group flow. Here I am presenting this thing essentially in that language. In other words, classicalization will play a role in order to understand the UV completion of a theory if the theory by itself flows in the deep UV into classicality, which by that we mean flow in the deep UV into large M physics, into large occupation number physics. Here I am representing just this cartoon. If you put N and you put E, you can start in a physical situation characterized by certain energy and certain occupation number, and you can see how the theory flows when you are increasing energy. In this type of theories that classicalize, otherwise the theory will not classicalize, what happens is that whenever we increase energy, the occupation number is increasing. Of course, at a certain point, you reach a regime where n is much, much larger than one, and you can use the Bogoliubov approximation in order to classicalize your theory and to deal with the theory partially in terms of C numbers instead of using operators. Of course, in this cartoon, that can be a little bit the cartoon of a renormalization group where we are adding this extra line corresponding to the occupation number together with energy, I am not representing any fixed point, any conformal field theory fixed point in the UV. I will just discuss a little bit probably this thing at the end of the talk if I have time, but in principle you can just flow into n going to infinity, or you can just stop at some conformal field theory point for some particular finite value of n, and we will try, and this is part of the description of this quantum phase transition, to unravel a little bit what could be the nature of the corresponding conformal field theory that appears in this fixed point. Note that underlying this flow, there is, if you want, a UV infrared correspondence. In what sense? In the sense that we are mapping states with low occupation number of very hard and strongly interacting quanta into states of large occupation number of weakly interacting soft quanta. This is very much related with gravity because if they are hard quanta, automatically, because the source of the gravitational interaction is energy, they will strongly interact. And in the moment you are able to transform this thing into soft quanta, but increasing the number, this will interact weakly because they are very soft. Underlying this thing, and I will not enter into this discussion, there is a sort of S duality, if you want, because we are mapping strongly interacting quanta into weakly interacting quanta. In other words, there is a map of using this classicalization as a way to discover what are the real natural variables to deal perturbatively with the UV regime. In this sense, the slogan will be just that self-completeness simply means UV classicalization. Now, in order to fix ideas, let me just start with frame the second part of the talk. Let me just start with a problem that is typical problem in gravity, which is the scattering of ultra Planckian energy of two quanta. Let me just consider an in state of two hard quanta with certain energy E and impact parameter B. And let me start at the beginning with energy much larger than the mass Planck, but the impact parameter to be very large, in other words, much larger than the typical scale characterizing the gravitational interaction, which is the gravitational radius. Now, what I will try to do, or to sketch in this transparency and in the next transparency, is a little bit what happened to this problem that we will just try to follow also in perturbation theory, when we just keep the energy fixed and we change the impact parameter B. And what happened when we reach the impact parameter B of the order of the gravitational radius. But in order to do it, what we will do is to try to describe what is happening, but from the point of view of what we can call the gravitational picture. What is the gravitational picture? The budget of energy of the system, there is part of the energy of the source, but there is also part of the energy that is the gravitational self-energy. Now, the gravitational self-energy of the system can be just simply represented in first approximation by the product of the energy multiplied by the gravitational radius divided by the typical size of the source, that in this case is the impact parameter B. And what you realize is that in this typical situation that is very perturbative, what you have is that this gravitational energy in the balance of energy of the system is a very small amount. In a certain sense, this is telling you something very intuitive, is that at this level of the discussion, the gravitational effects are essentially negligible. Now we can try to describe this gravitational piece of the energy in terms of a graviton number, just simply decomposing, if you want, the Newtonian potential in terms of graviton number. Then in principle you expect that the gravitons that are describing this situation, this gravitational energy, are gravitons with typical wavelength of the order of the size of the source, which is B. And the number of gravitons, of course, you will have a distribution of gravitons of different wavelength, but the maximal number of gravitons will be at this wavelength of the order of the size of the source. And this number is represented here by E multiplied by Rg divided by H bar. This is purely quantum mechanical quantity that in the H bar going to zero limit, of course, goes to infinity. Now, the graviton interaction is something that you can just simply discover if you are assuming that this sort of gravitons are with wavelength of the order B. And the graviton interaction that we are denoting alpha gravity is just L Planck squared divided by B squared, that you can see here that is much smaller than 1 over n. What you discover even at this level of the discussion is that the gravitational picture of the problem, when you are working at energies which are much larger than the mass Planck, automatically leads you into a gravitational picture with a large number of gravitons and very softly interacting, much softer than 1 over n. Now imagine that you just simply try to approximate this gravitational description of the problem using the Bogoliubov approximation, and you say, okay, since I am working with n much larger than 1, let me just consider a Bose condensate of these n e gravitons. And to describe the situation in this gravitational piece, using the order parameter of the corresponding Bose-Einstein condensate, that is the one solving the Gross-Pitajewski equation. Of course, this is representing essentially the gravitational potential acting between these two guys. From the point of view of perturbation theory, in a certain sense, what we are doing at this level is just representing in terms of a Bose gas of gravitons, the Econal approximation, where the number of gravitons exchanged will be n, the same n that we are putting here, and where we are not considering, we are considering these gravitons almost free, we are not introducing any interaction among these gravitons because this gravity is very small, 1 over n. Then the stationary phase approximation to this Econal approximation will be mapped essentially into the solution of the order parameter of the corresponding Gross-Pitajewski equation. Now let's see what happens if we maintain E fixed, but we just start reducing B. And we are interested in following, in tracking this process from the point of view of the gravitational picture. Now, from the point of view of the Bose-Einstein condensate, and this is very important to understand the rest of the discussion, what we are doing when we are changing B is keeping the number of gravitons the same, but we are increasing the strength of the interaction. And the strength of the interaction is increasing because the wavelength of these gravitons that are characterizing the gravitational contribution to the problem is diminishing. At the same time, the gravitational part of the energy in the budget of energy is increasing. From the point of view of the perturbation theory, you can imagine that you are considering the contribution of H type of diagrams to this type of phenomena. Now what happens, and this is essentially the essence of the talk, what happens when we reach the impact parameter of the order of the gravitational radius? That is the point where we expect to create a black hole. But for ignoring for the time being what we are our expectation from the point of view of quantum field theory, let's try to see what the Bose condensate is telling us, what many body physics is telling us about what happened when the Bose condensate of these gravitons, when B reached the value of the gravitational radius. Now, it's easy to notice that at this point, the gravitational part of the energy is of the same order as the total energy, which means that the system is dominated by gravity. Gravity is the relevant interaction here, it's not anymore something negligible. And the interaction among the gravitons is precisely 1 over n. We are reaching before, remember, that the gravitons were interacting very weakly, much smaller than 1 over n, but at this particular point we reach this beautiful correspondence that the graviton interaction is precisely 1 over n. Now here you can just discover, just analyzing the problem from the point of view of the Bose-Einstein condensate, that the system can become self-sustained, in the sense that the quantum pressure compensates the gravitational attraction. What I will try to describe in the rest of the talk is that at this point, the Bose-Einstein condensate undergoes a quantum phase transition. This quantum phase transition is, of course, a spontaneous breaking of the symmetry and comes with the Goldstone bosons and so on and so forth, but from the point of view of the many body physics. This is what we will try to argue that corresponds to the black hole formation, and this will be the one that is generating the imaginary part contribution to the scattering amplitude. In this cartoon, I am just simply representing the coupling alpha gravity. This is the critical point that I will just claim in the next part of the talk, 1 over n. Here we have a weakly coupled uniform Bose-Einstein condensate corresponding to diagrams of this type, to these ladders of gravitons, or to get the diagrams of this type whenever we are increasing the coupling and introducing more and more interaction effect among the gravitons. Then we reach a particular point, 1 over n, where we expect that we generate the imaginary part, which means a bound state, and we want to identify this situation with this quantum phase transition, with the corresponding symmetry breaking, with the formation of a black hole. From the point of view of unitarization, what could be this thing telling us is that this quantum phase transition, or you want this kind of gravitational Higgs phenomena, is what is unitarizing these gravitational amplitudes. Then in the second part of the talk, I will try to argue that the black hole, this particular critical point of this quantum phase transition of the gravitational Bose-Einstein condensate. Of course, in order to claim that, I will be forced to tell something about the characteristic features of black holes, as it is the entropy of the Hawking radiation. Okay, before going into that, let me just summarize a little bit with a toy model the fundamental concepts that we are going to use in describing this quantum phase transition. This is well known in condensed matter physics, and there are even experimental situation where people are working with this type of quantum phase transition using ions and so on and so forth. I am not a specialist on that, and then I cannot tell you anything else, but apparently this is something that you can check in the laboratory for some toy models. But let's consider just simply a toy model of a gas of n interacting bosons with interaction that is attractive in order to mimic what we expect from gravity, living in a compact space in 1+1 dimension. Here I represent, for convenience later, the corresponding creation and annihilation operators of these bosons by the operator A and A target. Okay, thank you very much. Now this, a weak coupling, this system condensate, the ground state would be a Bose condensate, and this Bose condensate can be characterized by the corresponding order parameter, which contains a quantum phase that is the solution to the Gross-Pitayesky equation. This will be just the ground state, we will have the coupling G, we are assuming that G is very small. This essentially is the chemical potential of the system, and we will have a uniform Bose condensate living here. Now, immediately, in Bose, once you have this type of Bose condensate, we are working at temperature equal to zero. The two next ingredients that you need in order to understand the physics of the problem are the low-lying Bogoliubov of quasiparticles, as well as the quantum depletion. Let me start with the low-lying Bogoliubov of quasiparticles. This is simply to understand what are the collective modes that are the real quantum fluctuation about the corresponding ground state defined by the Bose condensate. This corresponds to solve the equation that is known as the Bogoliubov of the Gen equation, and the typical tool to use to solve this equation is to introduce a Bogoliubov transformation. incidental Lyapunov of transformations that are very popular after Hawking derivation of temperature for black holes appears originally in this setup and were originated by Bogoliubov analyzing this type of problems. Now, the Bogoliubov transformation is going to relate the operators. I am not having here anymore. No, okay, forget it. Relating the operators A, that are the creation annihilation operators of the bosons we start with the B and B dagger operators that are the ones creating the quasi-particles about the corresponding ground state. Now, the interesting thing for us will be just the spectrum of Bogoliubov modes. And here, the thing where we are concentrating is in the mass gap that I am representing here by delta G, which is the difference in energy between the first Bogoliubov excitation and the ground state. Of course, the ground state is playing the role of a vacuum with respect to the B operators. But due to the fact that this Bogoliubov transformation is non-trivial, we can have an expectation value different from zero for the number operator of A particles, which essentially will be the gravitons in the case that we are considering next. These are the bosons that are the constituents of the Bose condensate we start with. Now, the delta nk that I am representing here is simply the average number of these bosons of momentum k that are living in the level k just by quantum fluctuation when we are in the ground state of the Bose condensate. For simplicity, let's concentrate on delta n1, which is the first level. Now, what we are interested in order to understand or to define what is a quantum phase transition in the system is to flow the to understand the spectral flow of the Bogoliubov modes with the coupling G. What can be observed in some of these systems is that when we move G, and that's the reason we call this quantum phase transition, because we are working at a temperature equal to zero, and we are only changing the coupling G, what we see is that the gap of the first Bogoliubov mode, delta, is going to zero at some particular G critical point. In other words, the first low-lying excitation of the Bogoliubov modes are becoming gapless at this particular critical point. And here, when we go beyond the critical point, we continue having some almost gapless excitations. This depends if you are working in the Bogoliubov approximation, in the mean field approximation, where you will have this thing strictly going to zero, or if you are working a little bit in 1 over n approximation, as we will just present in the next transparency, when you will see a little bit the structure of this critical point. In the 1 plus 1 dimensional system analyzed in the literature, this phase transition corresponds to go from the homogeneous Bose condensate for G smaller than G critical into a solitonic phase for G critical bigger than G. What happened is that these bosons here that they were distributed uniformly for the small coupling, they become organized in a soliton, and the way they can do that remain in a condensate is because they can use these low-lying modes in order to get the quantum pressure that is compensating the extra interaction when you are increasing the coupling G. Then at the critical point, these low-lying Bogoliubov modes become gapless, and in principle you can describe this critical point in terms of critical exponents. There are 2 critical exponents that are relevant here. One is the critical exponent characterizing how the gap goes to zero, that is G minus G critical to some exponent delta 1, and also the depletion, because since you have more and more low-lying modes here near the critical point, you can easily understand that the quantum depletion is increasing because there are more possibilities for the bosons to be in levels which are not exactly the ground state. Then the quantum depletion is increasing and the mass gap is decreasing, and this characterizes the 2 critical exponents. In the Bogoliubov mean field approximation, of course, this exponent will be of the order of 1/2. Then let's try to export this picture into the case of the 3 plus 1 dimensional gravitational system. Then in principle, just consider a 3 plus 1 gravitation in Minkowski space, gravitational condensate of bosons. And then what we will do is just to follow the Bogoliubov spectrum of the system. Now, in this weak coupling regime, remember the example that I presented for the scattering amplitude, before reaching the critical point 1 over n, what we have is gravity in the presence of external sources, which is like the case of before when we were having the uniform Bose gas in a confining region of space. Now, when you reach this critical point, 1 over n, what happens is that the low-lying modes of this Bogoliubov quasi-particles become gapless. This is very interesting, and this will be what we will use, or what we will, the tool that we will use in order to argue what is the origin of the black hole entropy, as we will see in the next transparency. Now, there are other features of this quantum phase transition. For instance, the speed of sound of this Bose condensate here will be smaller than C in the region where the coupling is smaller than 1 over n, and will become equal to the speed of light when we reach this critical point. This is specific of this 3 plus 1 gravitational Bose-Einstein condensate. There are features that are similar to the 1 plus 1 dimensional case I presented before, and other features, as I will say in a moment, that are different. Now, this point, this corresponds to a self-sustained Bose condensate, and we can just characterize what is the typical mass of this system and what is the typical size of this system, because now it's self-sustained and localized. Now, the mass is given in terms of n. N is fixed, which is the number of gravitons we start with, and is given by the square root of n in units of mass Planck, and the radius is the square root of n in units of the Planck length. I am avoiding just numerical factors here, but this is the typical relation, as you can see, the first hint that we are just close to something that can be a black hole, because the relation between the mass and the size is the typical one that we get for Schwarzschild black holes. Of course, if we want to claim anything about these fellows, we need to have at least a qualitative understanding. Will be to have a quantitative understanding. This is something that we are just working on. But let me just give you in this transparency a qualitative understanding of the black hole entropy. As I was saying before, at this critical point, what happened is that we have a lot of low-lying quasi-particles or Bogoliubov modes that become gapless. Then let's highlight this critical point, and when we highlight this critical point and we keep n finite, in other words, we are not in the really mean field approximation corresponding to n equal infinity, what we see is in a gap of energy of order 1 over square root of n. Remember, square root of n was the typical size of the self-sustained Bose condensate we get at the critical point. We get that all these low-lying Bogoliubov modes are spreading in this small regime 1 over square root of n, and you have an almost degenerate Bose-Einstein condensate ground state. You can label this quasi-degeneration, if you want, by the index I that I put here, and in principle you can have a picture that is reminiscent of the picture that we use sometimes with deep brains. That is, you say, oh, my Bose condensate now has the possibility at this particular critical point to have different ground states. That, of course, the resolution is order 1 over n, but in principle are very near, and then the quasi-particles corresponding to fluctuation going from one into another of the corresponding Bose condensates quasi-degenerate at the critical point. This is my spectrum of Bogoliubov zero modes. And you can see in this particular example that the n fixes for you the number of different types of Bogoliubov zero modes. And in principle, if you just simply define the microcanonical entropy as the degeneration at the critical point of the ground state, you will get that the entropy is of the order n. Of course, at this level of analysis, we cannot say anything about any numerical factor. We are just simply trying to understand what could be the typical degrees of freedom that are responsible accounting for the entropy. The emerging picture here, because this is essentially you want the many body representation, this Bogoliubov modes of the Goldstone bosons of the underlying breaking of symmetry. The emerging picture here is that the holographic degrees of freedom, that is the typical guys that we expect account for the entropy of the black hole, are these almost gapless Bogoliubov quasi-particles. The number of different Bogoliubov modes, you can try to interpret as the corresponding conformal field theory characterizing this critical point, that will be characterized by the critical exponent I mentioned before, but also by a central extension, if you want, this is just pure imagination, of the order of the number of different type of species of Bogoliubov, or the number of Bogoliubov zero modes. Now, this, in principle, you can also go a little bit and to try to get not just simply this microcanonical entropy, and you can try to get the quantum correction, just following a little bit, or trying to connect with the recent computation, beautiful computation by Ashok. Now, here, what I am going to say is something extremely simple. Since at the critical point we have a degeneration of vacuo at this particular alpha gravity equal 1 over m, the pure state of the black hole is expected to be just a quantum superposition among these states. Now the corresponding density matrix will be just the normal density matrix you get by this quantum superposition. But of course, whenever you measure, this is just the von Neumann idea, whenever you measure this quantum state, whenever you just wash out the off-diagonal pieces of the density matrix, you gain an entropy. This von Neumann entropy that you will gain when you just wash out, just for instance, putting interaction with bath, or just simply measuring the system, will be, in this particular case, of the order of log n, and of, by the way, with a positive sign. Okay, this is just a marginal comment. Now, what happened about in the last 1 minute? No, not one minute. let me just say one word, because otherwise Spenta will kill me. What about depletion and Hawking radiation? Now, at the critical point, we can just describe the situation of the spectrum, and then we have the continuous spectrum and the volume of discrete modes. Now, the particularity of this Bose condensate is that it has an escape energy that is of the order 1 over n, and this is what we characterize saying that the Bose condensate is leaky. Then just analyzing quantum field theory possibility to one of these fellows to go into the continuous spectrum, we get a depletion law, which is the one that I am representing here, that in the semi-classical limit coincides with the Hawking-Stefan-Boltzmann law for black holes with the corresponding Hawking temperature given by the radius. The thermality of the spectrum is coming in this particular case due to combinatorial factors. Now, let me just say one word. In this particular 3 plus 1 dimensional system, there is difference with respect to the 1 plus 1, and this is that we cannot define these stable solitons. What this means is that the low-lying volume of modes are unable to create enough quantum pressure to compensate the attraction. That's the reason the system collapses, but collapses in a cell-similar cascade of depletion. That is what I am representing here in a cartoon, going from n to n-1 to n-2 and so on and so forth, diminishing the corresponding escape energy and following the corresponding depletion law. Now, I don't want to... Of course, in this approach, we are able to compute 1 over n effects, and the 1 over n effect that I just want to mention, corresponding to here, is that in this model, when we keep n finite, that the black holes can carry hair with respect to global symmetries, and the rate of emission of this global hair is characterized by this expression, that of course in the limit n going to infinity, which is the semi-classical limit for B finite, will give you to no hair. But whenever B is of the order n, we can have 1 over n effects of hair that are of potential astrophysical consequences. And let me finish here, because I'm sorry for going beyond my time, and thank you very much for your attention.
I'll take one question. Yes.
So when you said that you have a fixed number of gravitons, but they have different energies, how is it compatible with the concept of second quantization? Why can't you create more gravitons?
I'm not sure I understand your question. Whenever you have a system, for instance, whatever distribution of matter, there is a gravitational self-interaction. Okay? And this gravitational self-interaction will depend on what energy you have. The only thing that I was doing in this presentation is to represent this gravitational self-interaction in quantum field theory terms as a set of gravitons, a distribution of different states with different value for the graviton number. Of course, this will be a distribution, but this distribution will be peak for gravitons of the wavelength of typical size of the source that I'm working with. This is the only thing I was using.